Hello, my name is Jacob, and I am a Norse pagan, and I'm still a photographer sometimes, and so I actually got invited to go down to Mexico to shoot a wedding down there, so I'll be traveling down there for about a week, but also I've decided to take this time to take a much-needed vacation. It's been a very long time. Since I'll already be down in Mexico, I might as well stay there for a little bit longer and enjoy the beach. So I will not be posting any content for a couple of weeks. I thought I would be able to get a backlog going, but it's just been so crazy and hectic lately, I haven't been able to do that, but I wanted to leave you with one more video until I take a little bit of a leave of absence. So I'm going to talk about the Prose and Poetic Eddas, because I'm going to be bringing these with me, because I wanted to do a little bit of research while I'm relaxing, mostly for the upcoming Loki week, which should be coming out here probably in 2 or 3 weeks after I get the research done and get back from my break. Since I'm already taking these books with me, I was like, you know what, this will be a good time to talk about them. Just because I didn't know everything about them. I know a little bit. I know the Codex Regis. I knew about Snorri Sturluson. But I didn't know the full context of their histories. So since I was already looking into that, I figured this would be really good information to share with all of you. Because I did find some really interesting facts. So for my last video for a couple of weeks, let me share with you the history of the Prose and Poetic Eddas. So the interesting thing about the Poetic and Prose Edda is the fact that Snorri's Edda, or the Younger Edda as it's sometimes called, was written in the 13th century and used the Poetic Edda, or at least the Codex Regis as it would one day be called, as a resource. But we actually didn't know where the Codex Regis was for several hundred more years. It wasn't until 1643 that the Poetic Edda, or the Codex Regis, was rediscovered in Denmark, and then it was kept in Denmark for several hundred years. It wasn't until 1971 that the Codex Regis was returned to Iceland, and it was actually transported on boat and had a naval escort to make sure it arrived safely. So it is a very treasured artifact. The Codex Regis, or the Poetic Edda, is really fascinating because it contains 31 poems that we actually don't know who the author was, or if there was multiple authors. We can also tell that most of the poems come from different time periods. There is no one date for the entire Codex Regis. Some stories seem to come from as early as the 7th century and go all the way up to the 9th century and beyond. While we do know that the Poetic Edda was most likely written by Christians, we don't see as many like Christian influences, at least not to the extent we see in Snorri's Edda. So that's why a lot of people tend to take the Poetic Edda more to heart and more as a serious document when it comes to researching Norse mythology, in particular the Norse religious side of things. One thing to note between the Codex Regis and a lot of translations of the Poetic Edda, much like my Crawford translation, there are a lot of poems that are actually added to various translations, and some poems taken out that were not originally in the Codex Regis. And some poems that were actually in the Codex Regis were taken out in certain translations just due to continuity or not seen as important. I do think it's smart to own multiple copies of the Poetic Edda, which is something I intend to do. In the Crawford translation, you actually get a story that isn't in the Codex Regis. You get Baldur's Drawmer, which is his dreams about death that Odin goes and investigates in hell. But then you also don't have a story in this translation. I forget the actual name of it, but there's a story where Idun actually falls from the world tree and like everyone is trying to help her and like Odin has to go talk to somebody and Heimdall is there. So that story is not even in Crawford's translation, but it's not even in the Codex Regis, but it's in other translations. So it is smart to own multiple translations just for the information you might pick up. But the actual Codex Regis itself was set at 31 poems. That's basically all I could find on the Codex Regis or the Poetic Edda. So I do want to talk about the Prose Edda, which is definitely a very controversial book in some areas, but as you've seen me in this channel explore in the last few months, it is an important document, it is an important textbook to learn a lot of stories we wouldn't know of otherwise. Now the reason I say textbook is because that's actually what it was written as by Snorri. This is a textbook for poetry, or for skaldic poetry. It actually wasn't written as a Norse mythology book, and Snorri did not write this with any intention of preserving Norse mythology. He was writing a textbook to teach other people how to write in a skaldic verse. And so that's how you have to actually look at this, because it's divided into 4 sections. The first few sections are more important to Norse mythology, where the ending sections are actually about poetry writing, which are really not that important to us today, unless you are looking to write in a skaldic format. So the 4 sections go as follows. The introduction is a prologue, and it's the Christian account of Norse mythology, which is one of the reasons so many people have a problem with the Prose Edda, including myself, is that it's a rewriting of the Nordic tales to basically make the gods not as important, and they are, like, you know, basically descendants of the Greeks, and there's, like, mentions of Troy, and, yeah, it basically discounts the Norse gods as really important. So, yeah, a lot of people have a problem with this. The next section is Gylfaginning, which is one that we get a lot of information from, because it really tells the story from the creation of the Nordic mythos all the way to the end at Ragnarok. So there's a lot of tales there that we wouldn't have otherwise, such as the tale of Utgard or Loki, and other such tales as, you know, Njord and Skadi's marriage. We wouldn't really know about if it wasn't for Gylfaginning. So Gylfaginning is important, but it is definitely ruined by the fact that, you know, you have this beginning section basically saying this is all, you know, just like history. This isn't really faith. This isn't really anything like that. This is just stories. But Gylfaginning is important. Skaldskap and Wall is the third section of the Prose Edda, and this is really when you get into the poetry writing aspect. The interesting frame in which this is told is quite fascinating. It's actually Aegir and Bragi discussing how to write poetry and what kennings to use for certain aspects of the Norse mythos. This is reinforced in section 4, which is Hattatal? And it is examples of Snorri's poetry. So this is really just him showing how to actually write the poetry in Old Norse, using the proper style of skaldic verse. Because Snorri was a skald and was very known for his poetry writing, and wrote many stories about the kings of Norway and Sweden, as well as people in Iceland. And I wanted to spend the last part of this talking about Snorri Sturluson himself, because this is also where we get a lot of issues with people having with the Prose Edda in particular. Because Snorri was a Christian. We really have no evidence to suggest that Snorri was a practitioner or really cared about the Norse pagan belief system. Now, he did record these stories down, which is important for us today. And like I said, we wouldn't have some of these stories if it wasn't for Snorri writing them down. But I don't know if he was actually writing it for a preservation sake. He really was just writing a textbook on how to create a skaldic verse and how to write skaldic poetry. Some basic facts about Snorri: he was born in 1179 and he was killed in 1241. He was actually assassinated as a political rival because he was part of multiple clan wars throughout his life. He did have a clan, so to speak, and he was involved in several small skirmishes across Iceland, and he actually retreated to Norway a couple of times to hide from these clan wars, and was actually kicked out of Norway the second time, and he was a devious politician. He was actually working against the Icelandic government. He was the law speaker for Iceland two times, once before he left for Norway the first time, and then was law speaker once again when he came back. And the whole time that Snorri was law speaker, he was installing laws and changing things so that he could eventually transition Iceland away from its, like, you know, independent nation all the way to being controlled by the King of Norway. This is one of the things that led to several clan wars and led to a lot of devious backroom politics, is that obviously a lot of clans of Iceland did not want to become in service to Norway. This is actually what led to him getting chased out of Iceland originally, as a force of 1,000 men actually chased him out. So he was not exactly what you would call a good person, or at least he was very devious. He was also morally not a really great person. From what I could tell, he only married once, but he had children from multiple women. I think he had 5 children from 3 different women and ended up having a really bad divorce his first marriage because he was cheating on her. So yeah, he's not exactly what I would call a great person. He really wasn't for the preservation of Iceland, and definitely seemed to be doing a lot of backroom politicking, which is eventually what led to his assassination. I mean, his house literally got stormed and he was killed in his basement. You know, that's Snorri's life. So this man had a very troubled life, and definitely, I don't know if it's one of those things where it's like, man, I'm proud of Snorri. I'm proud Snorri's the person that recorded our stories down. Not really. So again, this is another reason a lot of people seem to have problems with the Prose Edda, and again, I don't like to beat a dead horse too much, because again, we wouldn't have a lot of information. We just have to really take it with a grain of salt. Snorri also wrote Heimskringla, which is the story of the you know, Norwegian and Swedish kings all the way from the 8th century to the 12th century. Now, this is an important work to record the, you know, at that time, the modern age of kings, but he also had the Ynglinga saga at the very beginning, which once again is kind of like the Prose Edda. He had this section that we don't really know much about. It's hard to actually decipher how much of it is true, if any of it is true, if it's just his own creative writing style. He basically has this whole section in Yngling Saga that talks about how the Norwegian kings all descended from the gods, or at least the god humans that existed at some point that eventually became gods. Now, some people in the faith do believe that the gods themselves were just people at one time that eventually were elevated into godhood, but there really is no one universal thought on this, so it's hard to take this seriously if you don't believe in that. But yeah, he basically says that Odin was a king at one point, Freyr was a king at one point, and that their dynasties live on today into the kings, or at least today as in his writing of Heimskringla, and that they, you know, are these godly, you know, kingdoms. In general, it is really hard to decipher these stories because there is a lot of contradicting information provided within Heimskringla that contradicts other stories and other accounts of the Norwegian and Swedish kings. So it's hard to say what is true, what is myth, what is legend, and what is, you know, completely made up. So as always, where does this leave us as a practitioner today? Are these books our Bibles? Is the Prose Edda a Bible? No. Is the Poetic Edda a Bible? No. We don't have a Bible. This is definitely more of a first-hand account, it seems, because these are stories written down by people that actually seem to have practiced the faith at one point and that were, you know, transcribed into one document later on. We at least know these stories are old. They have some truth to them. They may have been watered down a little bit by Christianity when they were recorded, but for the most part, we can trust the Poetic Edda, or at least it's the most trustworthy document we have of the Norse faith. Now, the Prose Edda definitely seems to be watered down by quite a few things. Not only are you watered down by the fact that Snorri was a Christian, you're watered down by the fact that this is a textbook for how to write in skaldic verse, and it's also watered down by the fact that you have Snorri's interpretation of Nordic myth going into it. But once again, some stories we wouldn't have otherwise, so sometimes it's all you got. I mean, we wouldn't know hardly anything about Skadi, Ullr, you know, and several other deities that we only have evidence of in the Prose Edda, so you have to take it with a grain of salt, like I have said. But these are definitely not Bibles. You know, this is barely a first-hand account. This is really a second-hand account of the Nordic stories. So they are important. I mean, I use them so many times in my videos. It's where we get, I mean, we wouldn't have anything if it wasn't for these two books. It's all we have, but, you know, we shouldn't take them as the, you know, the word and the law of the Norse faith. We are the living evolution of a faith that was passed down ancestrally and orally by people in the northern lands. These stories were a capstone for those moments where we wrote down those stories, but we're in the modern age now. We're in a new saga. We're having new interactions with the gods. We're having new stories. And so while these can inform us of the past, we have to, you know, accept the fact that we are moving forward as a faith. I do still always recommend that you pick up a really good history textbook to, you know, look at the past, look at the artifacts, look at what we know from history and science and data, and then take those things and combine it with the Prose and the Poetic Edda, and then take your own experiences now, take the experiences of others, mash all those things together, and that's kind of what you have Norse paganism as it is today. I'm excited to get some more research done, and particularly on Loki, so look forward to Loki's week basically as soon as I get back, but I will be taking a couple of weeks off, like I said, I'm looking forward to my vacation, and please make sure you keep on watching my videos. I got a huge backlog. I guarantee you haven't watched them all. So I'm really excited to get some more content out here, but I'm also really excited for this break. So as always, thank you very much, and until the haul, skull. Hello, it's me once again, and I'm here to do my YouTuber due diligence, so please make sure you like and subscribe, and thank you so much for your views. I'm glad you're enjoying the content here, but if you want to get more involved with the Wisdom of Odin, please think about donating to Patreon. Not only do you get to gain access to the Discord community, you get a lot of other great benefits, and you get to support this channel in the coming months, and I hope to produce so many more, you know, wonderful videos in the coming months, but I am ready for this vacation. So thank you so much once again, and until the haul, skull.